here in lovely Batavia on a chilly August morning to continue our virtual tour of the Chicago Aurora and Elgin Railway station stops and facilities. And we're actually in the middle of the Fox River, about a block or so, a tenth of a mile south of the Wilson Street Bridge, right behind us here in lovely downtown Batavia. And today we're going to be doing the Batavia branch or spur of the Chicago Aurora and Elgin Railway.
The Batavia Spur was the shortest of the five branches of the Chicago Aurora and Elgin Railway. It's less than 6 miles in length and has 8 stops, and that includes the terminus and the Batavia Junction.
This spur or branch was started in 1902 and was one of the original branches, unlike the Geneva Spur, which was started later in 1909. This branch came with the Aurora Elgin as well as the mainline spurs. The other nice thing about this branch is that 88% of the trailway, the trackway, is still accessible today. About 0.7 miles of the total 6 mile length has been deprecated, and as we'll see, that's almost entirely between the Bilter Road stop station and the Batavia Junction. But the rest of it is still fairly intact. The statistics on this branch were that it had 8 stations, 5 bridges, 1 underpass, and 1 very large powerhouse. So please join us on this journey, and we'll start right behind us at 2 East Wilson Street in downtown Batavia. We'll see you there. Okay, we're here at the origin terminal of the Batavia branch in downtown Batavia, with the southeast corner of where the Fox River meets Wilson Street in Batavia. And behind us, right there, at 2 East Wilson Street, is the origin terminal, the Batavia terminal. And as you can see, it's a stone and brick structure still in very good repair, I think partly due to the city of Batavia, which went through extensive repairs with it before they sold the building a few years back. But this is the side of the building that most of the passengers of the Chicago Aurora and Elgin would have seen when they came into, from the south, the station. There was an elevated platform right at the foot of the door, right there, with a canopy overhead, and then a boardwalk along the side, and the train would have pulled right in. Passengers would have ingressed, egressed directly onto that long extended platform, and then they could have gone into the station there, or they could have walked up the staircase to Wilson Street. This was a full stop, full ticket sales. I'm not sure what else went on within the station, but this is a big tick because this is a station in good repair, still standing. So it's a good way to start our virtual tour of the Batavia branch. So now we're going to go up the staircase. Wilson Street. And we'll cross the street here. So this is the Tomley building, built by Ole and Birgitta Tomley in about 1878. And it was for their furniture making and coffin making business. I believe that this was the shop and this was where they sold the furniture, next door at 4 East Wilson. Ole and Birgitta were Norwegian immigrants, and they're buried about 1/10 of a mile due north of here, I believe in the East Batavia Cemetery. And one more thing before we leave this terminal is that from here to the next station, Glendwood Park, down the line here, heading south, that's all up via overhead trolley wires. And it won't convert to the third rail until we get to the next station at Glendwood Park, which is, I believe, less than a mile down the path here. So we'll see you at Glendwood Park. Silver car, which is there off in the distance. And to the right would have been a very large brick structure, which would have been the powerhouse. The trackway would have come straight on through. We would have been standing on the trackway right here and going right through the parking lot. So this is a small portion of the trackway that's been also deprecated. You can ride through the parking lot if you choose to, but the actual trail, the actual Fox River Trail, bends around in a D fashion around this parking lot. In the early 1900s, electrical power could not be bought as there were few or no electrical utilities in northern Illinois at the time. And so in 1902, the ae&c Railway built their own power plant, a powerhouse, designed to power over 100 miles of ae&c trackway. This was a steam-powered plant using water from the nearby Fox River, coal to fuel 10 large boilers, and with two massive chimneys continually belching smoke, generating a daily average load of 115,000 kilowatt-hours of power and distributing more than 26,000 volts AC to four overland main lines, these being at Prince Crossing, West Chicago, Aurora, and Lombard. These main substations, in turn, would distribute to other substations, such as Clintonville. By 1910, the powerhouse was additionally providing power to many communities between the Fox River and Chicago, as well as powering over 70 miles of trackway for three other electric railways in the area. The electrical power that the Glendwood powerhouse generated was alternating current rather than direct current, as it was more efficient and less costly at that time to convert AC voltages for distribution, as well as operate and maintain the power transmission lines. And it should be noted that this was 25 hertz or 25 cycles per second AC power, which was good for railways, but not so good for home usage. Think of flickering lights. It took a few more decades before the plant fully converted to 60 hertz AC, which is what is used today, at least in the US. And by that time, the power plant had been sold to local power companies.
In addition to the powerhouse, this site provided another valuable asset to the railway. Within a year of building the powerhouse, the railway added Glendwood Park, which featured park grounds with a restaurant, ice cream parlor, dance halls, and refreshment halls, plus 100 acres of woods, all designed to entice Chicago City dwellers from the heat and rush of the city, of course using the Chicago Aurora and Elgin Railroad for transportation. In time, it became the line's biggest attraction. Park traffic peaked in the early 1920s, but then fell off over time. By the 1930s, as the amusement park business faded, Glendwood Park became a WPA camp for several years, and the station itself became a modest flag stop with a low-level asphalt platform and a small wooden shelter, about 8x8, with a gabled roof. Ironically, Glendwood Park still serves as an amusement area to this day, featuring Funway, an indoor-outdoor family play destination, along with the adjacent Glendwood Park Forest Preserve, managed by the Kane County Forest Preserve District.
The Glendwood Park powerhouse was finally torn down in 1965, several years after the railway closed. It should also be mentioned that there were sightings to the east of the power plant here, and also that from here on in, from Glendwood Park Station, power would be all by the third rail and no longer by the overhead trolley wires. So we'll see you at the next station at Hart Road. So we've stopped real quick just to get a closer look. This is a Chicago Burlington Quincy underpass. The CB&Q railway runs overhead, a big one overhead. So this is still part of the original infrastructure from the Chicago Aurora and Elgin Railway. And it's still standing today. So one other feature in the shadow of the roadway bridge here, right by the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy underpass, is a very nice little bridge. And you can see that it goes over this rather sedate creek, or at least sedate today. And if you come down here, you can see this is part of the original infrastructure built for the railway over 100 years ago. And it's just a nice little feature of this spur that still exists today. So within a few hundred feet of each other, we have the Chicago Burlington and Quincy underpass, and we have this nice little bridge going over a creek I don't know the name of. But if we just go to the other side, there's a little bit more to be seen, I think. And it's this very peaceful looking, serene little spot along the pathway. So if you're taking the spur, take a moment to look at this very serene, tranquil spot, and you'll also see a bit of the infrastructure for the Batavia line from over 100 years ago. So the Hart Road station was located in the southwest corner of the intersection of Hart Road and the trackway. So this station or stop was established in 1902. It was a flag stop and it was located about 45 feet from the west edge of Hart Road here. Which would have put it right in this vicinity right here. And it was a small wood frame structure about 6x6 with a gable roof. And it had a long cinder platform. And this stop would have been primarily used for milk delivery from farmers. They would load their milk for their dairy products, their milk containers at this stop. And it would be transported eastward into the Chicago market. Hart Road and the station were likely named for George and Mary Gerber Hart, or possibly William and Sabrina Rouse Hart. They were local landowners and farmers whose property was traversed by the railway. And they're buried in the East Batavia Cemetery, which is also where Ole and Birgitta Tumley are buried. So on to the next station. Okay, we've ridden the 0.6 miles to Raden Road Station.
I think it's Redant.
Ah, okay. Redant Road Station. So the Redant Road Station was located at the southwest corner of the intersection of Redant Road with the trackway and likely consisted of a long wooden platform, again, perhaps 40 to 50 feet long, primarily for the purpose of loading and unloading milk containers for local farmers to deliver their produce into the Chicago markets. This station was a flag stop. It was likely closed down in earlier than 1920, possibly because of the proximity of the Hart Road station, which was a little over half a mile to the west, as well as the Wagner Road station, which was located about 3/10 of a mile to the east. So perhaps this station was believed to not be needed or got low usage. The road, as well as the station, were likely named for local farmers and landowners, Frederick and Henrietta Hausbredon. And they too are buried in the East Batavia Cemetery. And so that marks several of the station named owners residing or buried in the East Batavia Cemetery. So if you want a little tour of many of the names associated with the Batavia branch of the Chicago Aurora and Elgin, you could visit the East Batavia Cemetery. So next stop is Wagner Road, which is just 0.3 miles due east of here. So we'll see you there. arrived at the Wagner Road station, which is just 0.3 miles from the Redden Road station, just due west of here. And this station was established in 1902 and closed down in 1957. It was located at the southeast corner of Wagner Road in the intersection with the trackway, and likely consisted of a long wooden platform, again about 50 feet long, primarily for the loading and unloading of milk containers for local dairy produce. And this road and station were likely named for Michael and Mary Wagner, or for his parents Peter and Catherine Heinen Wagner, who were local farmers and landowners. And they too are buried in the East Batavia Cemetery. So the next stop on our journey is further up the road, about 1.5 miles, to the State Road Station. So we'll see you there. Goes over a small creek, and that was this bridge is recorded on some of the maps for the original railway, and you can still see three piers still standing. There's one in the middle, one on the left, and one on the right. The bridge itself looks modern and good for a bike trail, but I believe that they reused the original piers that for the railway, for this bike trail bridge. So we found yet another artifact of the railway here. So this is one of the remaining artifacts on the Batavia branch of the Chicago, Aurora, and Elgin Railway. This is a signal base, concrete signal base, that is tipped over, but you can see the remaining iron strapping that held the signal in place, and the bolts, of course. But this is between State Road, Butterfield Road, and Wagner Road, and just a short distance south of the bridge, and on the northeast side of the path. Thank you. stop, which is about 1.5 miles down the pathway. And the state road station would have been located right about where I'm pointing that clump of trees right there, which is about 110, 120 feet off the south edge of what was State Road is now Butterfield Road. And this would have been a small wooden structure, about 6x6 perhaps, frame structure with a cinder platform, I think, initially, and then a wooden platform. Again, this stop was primarily used for the delivery of milk containers for local farmers to get their milk produce into the Chicago markets. This was established in 1902 and was open till the railway shut down in 1957. So Butterfield Road is a heavily trafficked road. So when you come this way along the Batavia Branch, take care of crossing it because there is quite a bit of traffic and truck traffic that comes along this road. So our next stop is Bilter Road, which is, of course, just up the way here, about 0.7 miles. So we'll see you at the Bilter Road station. Bilter Road station or stop, and this was located right in here. Today there's a parking area for bikers using the Prairie Path, and the station would have been located right here on the southwest corner of where Bilter Road meets the trackway. Right in this vicinity. And like most of the stops along this trackway, it would have consisted of a 40 or 50 foot long platform. Again, being a rural stop, it was primarily for dairy product freight to and from the city. And this stop station was open in 1902 and shut down with the rest of the railway in 1957. Station stop, as well as the road, were likely named for Herman Henry Bilter and Elizabeth Rosencrantz Bilter. They were local farmers and landowners. And once again, they're buried in the East Batavia Cemetery. So there you go. So this was the final stop prior to Batavia Junction, the final stop on the Batavia line at Bilter Road. Thank you. we've just ridden down from Belter Road due north of here to the point in the bike pathway that diverges significantly to the east and northeast. We're just stopping and pausing here just to point out that from this point on, the trackway, the path, bike pathway diverges significantly from the original line of the Batavia branch, which next should take us to Batavia Junction or Eola Junction. And there's a good reason for that. This is a nice bike pathway. I don't mean to disparage it, but it takes you this far east and then south because there's no good place to cross Illinois Interstate 88, which is a very heavily trafficked road with trucks, etc. There's no good way for pedestrians or cyclists to get across. And so that requires, there is an underpass that has just been built, a very nice underpass as part of the Illinois Prairie Path. So this path will take you about 2 miles to join up with the 1.5 miles to join up with the Aurora branch of the Illinois Prairie Path, the southern spur of the Illinois Prairie Path. So we'll show you this path for completeness, but you're no longer on anywhere near the original trackway of the Batavia branch, Batavia Spur of the Chicago Aurora and Elgin. But it is a nice bike pathway, so. We've now arrived at Batavia Junction, sometimes referred to as Eola Junction. In fact, the station was established in 1902 as Eola Junction, then was renamed to Batavia Junction around 1912 and closed on the 3rd of July in 1957 with the closure of the railway. Batavia Junction was the final stop on the Batavia Spur before joining up with the Aurora branch. This was a full stop with a modest-sized frame building about 8 feet by 8 feet with a hip roof, nestled between two high-level platforms, one on the Aurora branch and one on the Batavia branch, designed for ease of passenger transfer between the two branches so as to keep the trains on schedule. The station was located just about where the rampway and fencing starts for the pedestrian bridge over Eola Road on the west side of the bridge, and then just south of the Illinois Prairie Path.
The original Chicago Aurora and Elgin route from Batavia Terminal to Batavia Junction was 5.9 miles, and it would have taken a Chicago Aurora and Elgin train about 10 minutes to complete. The remaining trip into Wheaton, an additional 9.1 miles, would have taken another 14 minutes, for a total of about 25 minutes for a 15-mile trip. This means that a train on the Batavia Spur would have averaged almost 40 miles per hour from Batavia to Wheaton, including stopping and passenger embarking and disembarking. Today, the Geneva Spur is a full 9 miles in length due to the additional distance from the Bilter Road station to Batavia Junction, and it takes a cyclist about an hour to ride in one direction. We'll talk more about Batavia Junction when we cover the Aurora branch of the Chicago Aurora and Elgin Railroad.
So we've just completed the virtual tour of the Batavia branch spur of the Chicago Aurora and Elgin Railway, taking in 8 station stops. So Joyce, what was your favorite or least favorite part of this trip?
Favorite part would probably be the station at the terminus in downtown Batavia along the Fox River there. It's a nice area, nice building. Least favorite would probably be the detour from Bilter Road to the where the branch connects with the Aurora Trail. It's just the path itself is fine, but you're riding along I-88, so it's noisy and just not as scenic.
Yeah, I agree. That was my least favorite part as well. I'm thankful that there's a bike path there, and it's a nice bike path, well maintained, but it's, as you say, riding along a highway, and it's noisy and not as nice as the rest of the path. My favorite part probably was not too far outside of Glendwood Park, departing from Glendwood Park when you come to the underpass by the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy Railroad, and then the small bridge that's sort of hidden away. It's kind of a small jewel along the spur. I suggest looking for that because it is a bit hard to spot as you're riding along. But that's a nice little serene, tranquil creek and bridge and reminder of this railway. So that was my favorite part. So that wraps our Batavia branch virtual tour. We're looking forward to the next branch, which should be coming soon. And if this was at all informative or entertaining to you, and you are so inclined, please like and subscribe. We'll see you then.